Hi, this is Randall Schwartz, host of FLOSS Weekly. This week, Simon Phipps joins me. Yes, he's back. We're going to talk about FenixEDU, which lets you keep track of almost everything about your higher education institutions. You're not going to want to miss this, so stay tuned.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for FLOSS Weekly is provided by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com.
This is FLOSS Weekly with Randall Schwartz and Simon Phipps. Episode 313, recorded October 22nd, 2014. FenixEDU. This episode is brought to you by Mandrill. Mandrill is a scalable, reliable, and secure email infrastructure service trusted by more than 300,000 customers. Sign up at mandrill.com, promo code TWIT, and you'll receive 50,000 free email sends per month for your first 6 months of service. It's time for FLOSS Weekly, the show about free, libre, open-source software. I am your host, Randall Schwartz, Merlin at StoneEdge.com, bringing you each week, or as often as I can, the movers, the shakers, the big projects, the little projects, projects you may be using every day and be totally unaware of it, projects you might want to look at using maybe because it's going to solve a problem for you. This week, no exception, which I should have said before that, we are usually helped by a co-host this week, no exception. There we go, that's English. Simon Phipps, welcome back to the show.
Well, hello, Randall. It's great to be back on the show again. I've aged since I last saw you then.
Yeah, you're looking a little gray. Are you trying out for the role of Santa Claus or something?
Yeah, I'm trying to fade into the white painted background and disappear. My second career actually is to be a Santa Claus. I like that job because you only have to work 1 month a year.
Only 1 month? I would think 1 day a year.
Well, maybe 1 day, yeah.
Awesome. And where are you speaking to us from?
I am speaking from my luxury office suite at the bottom of my garden in Southampton.
Yes, and Simon, actually, I want to say welcome back to the show in the most literal sense. I don't think I've done a show with you in, what, about 2 months?
Yeah, every time we nearly did a show together, one of us disappeared, I seem to remember. So the only ones I've done have been while you've been away.
It's all been cursed, I guess. Yes, well, that's cool. And for those of you that recognize the background behind me who are watching the video, yes, in fact, I'm back at ZipRecruiter down in Santa Monica, one of my favorite clients. I've been paying my bills for almost a year now, which I really appreciate. And unfortunately, the Big Blue Yeti is up in Portland, so I won't be using that. I'm using this sort of teeny-sounding headset, but it doesn't sound too bad most of the time. So anyway, the show's not about us. It's about our guest. This week's guest, no exception. Pull up my notes here. The project is called FenixEDU. And it's being represented by Artur Ventura, who's going to be speaking to us in a moment. Looks like what FenixEDU is about higher education management of all the data that goes on, all the student-related data, the administrative data, staff-related things, and so on. So, and it's all, of course, all open source. We'll talk more about that as we interview our guest. What have you seen about this so far, Simon?
So the briefing notes were the first time I'd ever heard of it. Looked pretty interesting. Looks kind of like a special purpose CMS to me. So I'll be interested to dig in and find out if there's more to it than that. Okay. They've got kind of curious licensing. It's a freestanding server project, yet it's licensed under the LGPL. So I'll be interested to find out why that happened.
Yeah,
I'm interested to find out some more about it. Never heard of it.
Very good, very good. I'm sure you'll have all your usual governance questions and things like that, but that's for later in the show. We'll just go ahead and, but before we actually bring on our guest, I actually have a little message for all yo, because, all yo, let's use English, Randall. So this episode is brought to you by Mandrill, a scalable, reliable, and secure email infrastructure service trusted by more than 300,000 customers. It's easy to set up and integrate with existing apps, and it's fast, too. Integrate, deliver, track, and analyze. Detailed delivery reports, advanced analytics, and a friendly interface mean that your entire team, from developers to marketers, can easily monitor and evaluate email performance. With servers all over the world, Mandrill can deliver your email in milliseconds. Mandrill started as an idea in 2010. Growing fast and innovating faster, Mandrill is now the largest email as a service platform on the market. Use Mandrill to send automated one-to-one email like password resets and welcome messages, as well as marketing emails and custom newsletters. We make it for developers who love documentation, integrations, high delivery rates, webhooks, and analytics. Mandrill comes with a beautiful interface, flexible template options, custom tagging, and advanced tracking and reports. Mandrill is the only email infrastructure service with a mobile app that lets you monitor delivery and troubleshoot from wherever you are. Here's the offer. It's powerful, scalable, and affordable, but you don't have to take our word for it. Right now, Mandrill is offering the TWIT audience, that's you, a special deal. Sign up at mandrill.com. Use the promo code TWIT, T-W-I-T, and you'll receive 50,000 free email sends per month for your first 6 months of service. That's pretty decent. That's Mandrill, M-A-N-D-R-I-L-L.com. Use the promo code TWIT. And now let's go ahead and bring on our guest, Artur Ventura. Welcome to the show.
Hi, happy to be here.
Very cool. And where are you speaking to us from?
I'm speaking from Lisbon, Technic Lisboa, which is a new university. We are the Portuguese equivalent to MIT, basically.
Very cool. Of course, you know, that'd be a great thing for anybody to claim, but yeah. I imagine you probably have some way to verify that. That's very cool. So I sort of gave my overview of what I think FenixEDU is about, but why don't you give us sort of the 30,000-foot view in that, you know, what problem is this solving and how does it attempt to solve it?
So our team, the FenixEDU team, is three things in one go. It's we are basically the Skunkworks division for our school. We create software specifically to solve problems, to simplify processes inside the school. Second, we function as advanced training for engineers. We are like special training, elite training for engineers, so they can learn to develop on real projects instead of academic tasks. And the third one is the software we produce. We try to make it open source. We developed a bunch of software. Initially, we started with something that it's called SIS, which is a student information system. It basically maintains who is enrolled on the school, who is taking what classes, how many credits do you have, the grades, teachers, etc. And we have another piece of software that's more like Moodle. It's a learning management system. Right now, we are trying to focus on higher education systems. We want to go through all possible venues of teaching there is. And our tools go beyond this. We are now trying to develop software for making processes that rely on paper easier and digitalize them. We are trying to create analytics tools. We are trying to make central authentication systems for our software, etc. We are making tools for all kinds of for all possible use cases the school has. But right now, our main two products, we call it products as a way to teach students about software development, because most of them don't know it, but they are not sold, obviously. But it's the SIS, the Student Information System, and the Learning Management System.
Cool. And how did this get started?
So basically in 1999, the school had some information system that was written in COBOL, and it was really, really old and was starting to become outdated. So after some master theses and final course projects, the school decided to create a project to develop a new information system for the school that was released as open source, but was more like the sources available, but it mostly was usable in here. Over about 2 years ago, we decided to redo the project because in Portugal, school universities are a bit different from universities on the United States. Here, the university is a bit a more relaxed organization, and the schools, each one of them, have more power to decide things. So the software we were doing is going to be installed on other schools of our university. And we needed to adapt it to handle those use cases that there are medicine courses that are very complicated to implement on an information system. And we are adapting our software to be easy to install, easy to customize to the needs of a school, etc. And that's where we've been right now. So now it's been 2 years. 2 years ago, as an example, the software didn't even boot up. You couldn't start a school from zero, and now you can start managing a school with little effort. The motive behind starting to develop something like this is that there are commercial solutions, but that creates two problems. First, they are really expensive, like a quarter of a million expensive. And the second one is that by developing us, the software, we can use it to teach students about software development. And that was one of the reasons behind releasing it as open source.
There's nothing wrong with using a few grad students as interns. That's pretty smart, I think, actually.
our students are paid.
We get
scholarships.
it's still though. So it started basically to solve your own problem. Are you at the point where you're eating your own dog food? I mean, is this actually now handling all of the issues for your school?
Regarding students, yes. All the information, our system is fully integrated. For instance, both the parking system is integrated to our information system. The scheduling of classrooms, some parts of the payroll system are integrated to our system. We have a lot of those sub parts of the school integrated into our systems, and it's really easy to do.
Now, obviously, this is intended, because it's open source, for more than just your particular school.
Yeah.
What sort of interest have you seen from other schools? How many have adopted it or begun to adopt it? And what sort of problems about portability and about adaptability have you seen resulting from that?
So most schools still have some archaic process of handling with these types of problems. Right now, our software is used in 6 schools. That amounts about 100,000 users of the system daily. We are in 2 countries. Seven schools. We are in 2 countries right now: Portugal and Mozambique. One of our big focuses is in developing countries, because our vision for the project is, by optimizing the education process, we can bootstrap a society. So developing countries are very important to us. We have 7 schools right now using FenixEDU, but in the next year we are going to get another 14, and we're trying to find more schools. What we want is to find more schools on another countries, because we have things that are specific to Portugal regarding to the certification process for schools. But we have, for instance, European countries. One of the most important programs on European Union is something called the Erasmus program. It allows students from one school to move to another for a year to study. And one of the things that even the European Union is trying to solve right now is how to send the information from one information system to another. And we want to be on another countries to simplify this process. So it's a big process. It's something that will take a lot of years. But by adopting our technology, schools can save a lot of money and a lot of resources. And if they are technology schools, they can even use their students to learn more about software by using an open source solution.
Right. I was going to ask you about that, Artur. Just how many developers are there from outside your institute? If you've got six schools who are using it, are they contributing development, or is it all your team that's doing it?
Unfortunately, Portugal lives in a bit of a consulting environment. So there are companies right now developing FenixEDU, but their contributions are maintained within the companies. We would love for them to bring it back to contribute back, but that's a bit hard to do in the current environment. But we are hopeful that in the future that will change.
Surely, I mean, I looked at your licensing. You're using LGPL, which in the context of this project means that you're essentially using GPL. Surely any consulting company that does work here has to make their revised code available under the terms of the GPL.
Yes, to the client, not to us. That's the main difference.
So your client would be able to make that available as well, though. So,
if they want to, they would. The code must be available to the school, not directly to us. If the school wants it, they can give it back to us. Yes.
Ah, fascinating. So, if any of those consulting companies did want to contribute back, what is the governance around FenixEDU like?
So right now, we are a team of 16 developers working exclusively on this software. We are more than welcome to receive anyone who wants to contribute, anyone to create a governance body to govern the steering of the project. But since most of the people working on this commercially are not right there, are not there right now, we are left with us governing. But we are more than welcome if other schools want to have something change on the software or want to contribute or want to participate on the project in some way, we are more than welcome to talk with them and to cooperate with them in any way.
Right. So how is the code structured? Is it, are there a lot of Portuguese comments in it, for example?
Oh, no. All the codes, except for some very, very, very old parts, the code is mostly on English. The code can be some structural leaning towards the Portuguese model, but that we are trying to remove that from the source code. The source code is one of the problems we are trying to solve. I don't know if any of you is a Java programmer, but there's this very important project on Java version 9 called Jigsaw about modularizing the JDK. We adopt the same philosophy on our system, and each school can choose exactly the modules they want. So all code is very isolated, very modular, and can be adopted and extended very, very easily. That was one of the main tasks we came to solve initially, to allow these differences between countries to happen.
Right. So what language is most of the code written in?
So our main architecture is built on Java. Initially, 10 years ago, we chose a framework that was popular back then, but now it's on end of life, called Struts. Right now, we are focusing on Spring and Angular. And in terms of web framework and persistence, we have a software that we developed in-house that is research projects that came into production on our system.
Right. So, and then what stack are you using underneath that? Presumably there's a Java web application server.
So in production in here, we are using Tomcat, if I'm not mistaken. In terms of persistence, we have something that we call Phoenix Framework, which is a software transactional machine that allows us to persist data versionally. One of the problems schools have, especially older schools, is that there's a lot of mistakes caused by having a lot of paper and being opened for many years. And our framework, our persistence framework, allows us to catch a lot of errors because it's bank grade safe It's consistency at a bank level. And that was one of the most important pieces of technology that we use, because that allows us to have versions on our databases. That allows us to simplify the programming, the coding process, but maintaining a secure environment where data is stored. And that's our persistence system. The problem is, because we developed our own persistence engine, we had to develop a web framework that we call Bennu, which is the Egyptian equivalent to a Phoenix. And the Bennu framework works is the basically interlocking mechanism to bridge Spring with our stuff. We also have a cool technology that allows us to integrate several technologies into one web page. We had environments where we need to have Spring, Angular, Struts. Some pieces are made on Vadin, which is a Swedish or Norwegian technology. And they all need to live within the same web application. We developed tools to allow this modularization that I was talking about to work on a web level system. That's why we have our own web framework.
Right. So are there alternatives for running that? So you say you're using Tomcat. Presumably it's going to mm-hmm. run on JBoss just fine.
Can I run it
on OpenJDK instead of on Oracle Java?
I believe not particularly, because we are dependent of some methods from the JVM. We probably on the next version of our framework, we will be able to run on OpenJDK. But due to performance issues, we have to use some special methods from Sun's JDK. But if that's a problem for a school, we are more than welcome to change that right now.
Right. And I see from you're up there on GitHub. I see you're FenixEDU on GitHub. I mm-hmm. see that you've also got SDK for Python. So presumably there's no problem in integrating Python code in.
In terms of functionalities within the application, yes, Python, PHP, it's all possible to do that way. Those SDKs are related to our API. Our software has APIs where students can make their own applications. One problem that we faced through the years was that since the school is governed by teachers tend to ask us to do a lot of stuff. So we found that making an API available and allowing those departments or teachers or someone else to develop their own tools that they need for some projects, some scholarships, some exchange program, something like that, simplifies our process and allows them to have what they want. So that's basically a REST API SDK for talking to FenixEDU instances.
Hey, so we actually had a question from the chat room. Hopefully my mute is not on. There we go. Here it is. We have a question from the chat room from Origosis. That's his stage name, I guess. He says, I am literally working with hundreds of schools in Rhode Island at this very moment. This is very relevant for me. So what would it take for him to get started? What kind of platform would he have to look at? What kind of scaling would he have to think about? What's the installation procedure? How would he integrate it with existing systems? How would he know whether it is possible to integrate with existing systems? Like, what's the flow from here? You've got somebody right here who wants to adopt this. What would you recommend to them? And they're actually listening right now.
So doing this for a big school is a very big process. We're talking about changing the way a school works. So, for instance, our school has about 10,000 people. During enrollments, our servers get hit as hard as DDoS. It's a lot of load. So the scenario for a big school is different from a small school. Regarding starting an installation process for a school, our objective for our software is to make it as easy to install as a WordPress installation. And if it's not there yet, will be soon. the best way for someone like that listener to do this is to contact us, and we are right now guiding schools to see if FenixEDU adapts to their needs or not. We have no problem to recommending other software, but the problem is saying this for, in some sense, this is an enterprise level tool. This is not something you install on a computer because it's fun. So depending on the school size, it may be easier or harder. Regarding interconnecting this system with other systems, it's relatively easy. We have APIs, like I said, REST APIs. We have mechanisms inside the system to extend the behavior from the system. The performance we are trying right now to make it as more as a technological achievement, if you will, make the software run on a Raspberry Pi, but it can run on basically any system. The problem is, we are talking about 10,000 users. We have mechanisms to allow this to scale linearly, but it's not something that you can just boot up a DigitalOcean instance or a AW3 instance and start running. It's a bit more complicated than that.
Do you have mechanisms for migration of existing data? Because I imagine, yeah, like if I'm switching to use this system for all of my student grading, I have years of history and some other mechanism for that.
Yeah. Right now, one of the things we're trying to do is to implement something that's called EMS Global, which is a standard between LMS and SIS systems. We are not there right now, but we'll be, and we are going to support it. We have ways for schools to port their data into our system that we are doing with other schools. So there's ways to do this, yes.
And I heard you mention earlier Angular. Are you talking about Angular JavaScript?
Yes.
And yes, so you have rich interfaces then that you're actually using? And how has that been for developing in terms of doing both server-side stuff and the stuff in Angular?
So I'm not, I haven't developed any interface in Angular. My role has been doing the mobile app, the a toolkit for our software, JavaScript toolkits, more like interface widgets. The need for rich interfaces is very big on a system like this for two reasons. Mm-hmm. We have some people here that are not very technologically savvy, so we need to have them be able to use the system intuitively, but make the software rich. The second one is that some concepts here are really complex. To allow certain things to happen, it's we have to have rich interfaces. But this is something that we've been studying for the past, 5 years, and we found out that Angular is the best solution. It allows us to have the same stack on terms of server and have a rich interface on terms of the user interface. And if the paradigm shifts again, we can easily replace it with something else. That's a big problem for us, because we've been here for 10 years, and in these 10 years, a lot of things change, and they will continue to change.
And so what does this look like from the perspective of the different audiences, in the sense of, I presume you're letting students log directly into it, and you're letting professors log into it, you're letting administration staff log into it, maybe financial people. What does their UI look like, and how does it differ among the different audiences?
So right now, it's basically a website. It's has common interfaces for some things like the school's communication to the students. Mm-hmm. One of the things this school has is a lot of students become teachers or employees, or they change around and employees become students. So the interface is quite homogeneous between those roles that people have. Basically, new portals appear between being a student, a teacher, or an employee.
Okay, so I wouldn't see too much difference, just like in the specific menu items that may show up.
No, new menu items appear, but it's the same system for everyone.
And I think you mentioned Moodle earlier. Does this integrate with Moodle or does it replace it?
The SIS part, what we call FenixEDU Academic, it's the admin office stuff. That one doesn't have Moodle. We are trying to create a new one called FenixEDU Learning, which is more or less like Moodle. It has course pages. It has student communication. We are exploring and seeing what people are doing in terms of MOOCs, massive online courses, and we are trying to adopt a lot of that into our learning platform. Moodle was a big no-no for us because Moodle was initially developed a lot, like 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. The word that people use after the word Moodle is sucks, most of the time. And it's an atrocious system. Seriously. And we're trying to create a new education system, a new learning system for a new generation, for a new world where people have laptops everywhere, where people have cell phones, where people have tablets. And that changes the paradigm on how people learn. And that's what we are trying to do. We're trying to make software software simplifying and optimizing the learning process for students. That's why we are completely rewriting the learning module.
Is part of your target audience then to do fully distance learning for some of your students?
Yes. One of our objectives is that it shouldn't be different for a remote student and a local student to learn. The interface should be the same. So we are going to give the teachers the same interface for both remote courses and local courses. There are a lot of cool stuff being made on edX, the most common platform for MOOCs, that we want to incorporate into our system, like online courses where you write code and it's evaluated on the server, like those, if you have made a MOOC, the booklets where you do a bunch of little tasks, read the text, see a movie, do a test. We want to incorporate that and make it available. But the most important tool we want to focus on is a content creation tool, because most of those systems have a serious flaw. They do not look to the software through the teacher's eye. They make it hard for people to create content, and we want to make tools to simplify the content creation process. And that's one of our big roadmaps for the future.
And in terms of that, are you looking at other solutions in the same space, particularly open source solutions, or are you sort of leading the way in this? Where do you think you are with respect to other projects in this area?
We've been looking to other projects. Most of them have some things that we want, and we try to incorporate them. But most of them. Our system is a bit hybrid. Originally, like I said, the system was the two parts together, the SIS, the academic stuff, and the learning stuff together in one system. Right now, we are trying to separate them and have two different projects. The SIS system, we haven't been able to find anything like it. There's very high-end solutions like Oracle and SAP solutions that cost thousands of dollars, but there isn't something like ours available open source and be easy to install. The learning module right now, it's a bit anemic, if you will, but we are ramping up right now to make it the best learning system out there, because what we see on other systems is very 90s approach to learning, and the world changed a lot since then, and we want to make the best learning system, and we want to learn hear about as many people as possible to make it that way.
Yeah, this is personally interesting to me because I've been getting a lot of pressure since I haven't been able to get 20 people in the same room for a very long time to learn Perl all at the same time. I've been getting a lot of pressure to do distance learning. When I last looked at this 4 or 5 years ago, there just really wasn't any products out there, commercial or not, that would make it easy for me to use as a content creator. And I'm not a dumb guy. I'm a programmer, you know, so I've got some skills. Yeah. But some of this stuff was just horrid. How are you finding the, you said it's still pretty early in your project, but how are you finding the adoption by your professors for content creation?
We are trying to, right now the project is starting. What mm-hmm. we had before was equal to what everyone else has. Mm-hmm. But we are still exploring some stuff. I don't know if you guys use OS X or Swift, the new mm-hmm. Programming language from Apple. They mm-hmm. have something called the Playground, where people interactively can test the language and appears the results on the right bar, including graphics, animations, stuff like that. We want to have that experience for users on our system, and right now there's nothing out there that does that. Other thing that we are talking about earlier today was one of your guests is going to be Docker, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
Yeah, so we are going to use probably Docker to do evaluation of projects. For instance, we launch an instance of Docker, and Perl could be running in there for you to evaluate your students' code. And that will be isolated, couldn't contaminate the rest of the installation, and will be much easier for you as a programmer to write a test evaluation tool on a sandbox environment than some weird system that doesn't work as you are used to.
Right. And so what about quizzes and tests and finals and things like that? Can I develop things that are mostly automatically scored, except for maybe some of the essay questions, or maybe, and some of the programming questions, we can do some automated tests against as well?
We have something of that available right now. It's not the best, and we want to replace it completely by something completely new. But we have something like that, yes.
And how much of this, in terms of content creation, am I spending long hours trying to type in the right XML or YAML versus just dragging and dropping it into the right place on my screen?
Our objective is to use tools that you are accustomed to, like drag and dropping, like making making small animations, stuff like that. For people not to write HTML. Tools should be simple, because as a computer engineer, I'm used to being able to do that. But for mm-hmm. instance, a biology teacher doesn't know about computers. Isn't that good with computers. So we must make the interfaces easier and simpler for them. So we cannot go through an approach of writing HTML.
Now, I've never gone to higher education at all, but I understand that one of the things that scares a lot of people is the enrollment period, trying to get all the classes that they want. Is there support in this system for enrollment?
Yeah, and it's highly, highly optimized. We have a small video on our Facebook page. Actually, one cool thing about this is because we are targeting a younger audience, we cannot use things like mailing lists or the usual tools that that open source projects use. So our page, our Facebook page, ends up being the most used way for us to communicate with our community. But in our Facebook page, there is a small video from our enrollment process where we can see the load that our servers endure during the enrollment process. And we can handle a very high load a very high load of requests on our servers, and we can do enrollment process online with no hassle for the students.
Okay, so to switch tracks a little bit, earlier on, you were talking about how you're looking for more users and more developers to join in with your community. I wonder, do you have some kind of a roadmap or a strategy for how you're going to spread Phoenix to more schools and particularly to more countries?
So in terms of software, we have a roadmap. It's on our documentation site. It's confluence.phenixedu.org. There's a roadmap link there. In terms of how to get more people to know our software, we're trying to promote it a bit. It's a bit hard because there are it's a very interesting point right now, because most schools, most big schools back in the 90s developed their own information systems, and right now they are starting to figure out that their system is not scaling enough, is not scaling well enough, and they are trying to search for new solutions for their problems. And we're trying to be one of those solutions by going to conferences and trying to find schools that are interested in our solution. But as you might imagine, this is a very, very niche market. It's software for schools. Right now we are at the higher education market, but we are trying to go into the high school and to preschool, and I don't know the terms in the US, but the lower schools of education.
Right. So in terms of spreading, what, you know, one of the key things there is to make the project accessible to new developers. Mm-hmm. Do you want to talk me through a little bit, what, you know, why did you pick the LGPL? Do you think that that's going to be a tool that's going to make the software spread more, or that it's going to be an inhibitor? It obviously hasn't helped you get more contributions from consultants.
I think that was before my time, so I don't know the rationale behind it. No one ever... That was never a concern for the people here. If there is a licensing problem right now that people want to address by some problem, they can talk with us. We can look into it and see if it makes sense. What I think most likely is that the LGPL was chosen because it was chosen. It was one. as all the ones available, that one probably at that time looked the most... the one that fitted our needs the best. I don't know, but
right.
as I told you, we are more than welcome to review that if that's a problem to anyone.
Yeah, there's a lot of people who think that the old GPL is a weak copyleft license and don't really understand that it's just the same as the GPL when you're using it in the body of a project. So do you own all the copyright to Phoenix? Does your school own all the copyright? I mean, what is your policy around copyright ownership and assignment?
So the brand FenixEDU is owned by our school. We don't mind people using it in terms of our software, but the brand is ours. The copyright right now, it's assigned to us because it was made that way. But new contributions probably would have the copyright of of who did the contributions. So that's not something that we are hanging on. So
right. Well, it's just that if you were ever going to want to change your open source license to something more modern, like you know, the Mozilla Public License V2 or to GPL V3. You would need to have ownership of the copyright to be able to do that. So many organizations that have chosen copyleft licenses choose to have copyright assignment as well, so that they have got that freedom in the future. But it sounds to me as if the project is, you haven't really considered collective governance very much. You're still very much focused on it being a project for your school rather than more widely governed.
No. We are open to have a more widely governed project. The problem is the approach that schools take is not one of internal development. If one school find, if one school suddenly wants to develop, wants to contribute back to FenixEDU, we will change the governance model at all, with no problem, and include them and make a steering committee of it. The problem, there isn't one right now, mostly because that never happened before. That's it. But right, we are right. More than welcome to accept that.
Right. I wonder if it's a tall chicken and egg here. I wonder whether one of the reasons why the consulting companies don't contribute back is because there isn't a mechanism for doing so that leaves them independent of your school.
No, I think that's a bit more due to their economic model. Their model is to pick up the software and install it. And the changes they do is mostly duct tape to shoehorn the system into that school. It's not something that we can incorporate back into the project normally. There are companies that do internal development and they chose not to contribute back.
Right. But that's very self-destructive.
I mean, everyone chooses what they want to do, but yeah. We never found out that the licensing model was a problem. If ever became one, if a school didn't want to adopt us because of our licensing model, we can review it and probably change it. We are open to all that. Like I said, the licensing model and the governance model are a byproduct from our development. It's not something that we developed consciously thinking about the how it grows. I think schools choose software because it fits their needs, not by the licensing module, mostly because the schools that are not technology-based simply subcontract that task to another company that installs their something. So until now, we never had a software licensing problem with our license. But like I said, we are more than welcome to review it if that's a problem.
We did actually have a question from the chat room just a bit earlier, see if I can scroll back and find it, which is, and actually I'm personally curious as well. Do you envision parts of this being useful for somebody like me who's a corporate trainer and wants to deliver courses with some distance learning involved and some, quizzes and tests and things like that? I mean, that doesn't have the whole life cycle of student enrolling, going through many courses, having some sort of degree program, whatever. Would this still be useful in that scale, or would that be sort of overkill?
So we in Portugal have a type of school which calls the literal translation is formation school or forming school, which okay. is basically it's a school where people go to get small courses on specific areas like Photoshop or words or painting or something like that, specialization courses. One of the things we want to adopt is something like that, which more or less matches what you are describing regarding corporate documentation and learning, which is small modules, education modules, that people learn on some topic, for instance, Photoshop. Our view right now is course-based. That means that, for instance, you have a class that has a syllabus and that's regarding, for instance, to calculus. But we want to find out more people, what people are interested in using in terms of education to adapt our system to a more broad reality. So that kind of environment we are very, very interested on adopting. But right now it's only higher education.
Okay. And also, you mentioned, of course, that the code is mostly in English, but in terms of internationalization and localization support, how many languages has your user interfaces been translated into?
Right now, two. Because we are on the European Union and mostly because of the Erasmus program, we have to support it in English. So the system is fully translated into English. But we would like to find more people to translate it. We are trying to see if the language, Portuguese school, higher education school, wants to, or the languages, if you will, wants to help us and get some students from the most speaking languages to help us translate for those languages. But right now, the languages that we support is Portuguese and English.
Cool. And Esol in the chat room also has a really interesting question. I think he's brought it up once or twice. This sounds like a competitor to Blackboard. How would you contrast this with Blackboard?
Like I said about Moodle, one of the reasons why we got into Hacker News was because people were complaining that Blackboard sucks. And this is a competitor to Blackboard, but it doesn't cost what Blackboard costs. And it's better.
Okay, that makes sense. Open source is always a plus, no matter what you're doing there. That's nice. Well, we're almost out of time, but a couple more questions I also want to make sure that we get to is, how would someone help? If someone said, this is interesting, I'm motivated by this, I'm not necessarily a professor or an administrator at a school, but I have some coding time available, what can I do? How can I, simulate this, install it, play with it, and then contribute code? And what, and in particular, what kinds of coders, or you said translators, are you looking for at this point?
So regarding translation, we still don't have the entire process done yet, but we will have on the following months a software to allow us to translate, to get the community to translate the software to us. Regarding the other things, we have an IRC channel on the Freenode network called FenixEDU, where you can join in. Our developers are there, and you can ask questions. You have our Facebook page, facebook.com/FenixEDU. You can ask questions there, too. If you want to try FenixEDU, we have a virtual machine that you can drop into VirtualBox and start and have a Phoenix instance running on your computer without installing anything. So you can try it out and see if it fits your needs. And if you want to develop, we have some documentation. One of our problems is we have not as much documentation as we would like. And we have some that allows you to start the system. But if you want to develop for it, if you have some needs, something, you can send us an email to hello@fenixedu.org or talk with us in any other of our channels, and we'll see if we can help you do that. For people wanting to contribute, our source code is available on FenixEDU, on GitHub. You can clone it. You can send issues, pull requests. We are like any other open source project, and if you talk with us, we will guide you through the initial stages of developing and teach you where things are and how to get stuff up and running.
What about, sounds like you're doing a lot of your development internally to your organization. Is there a chance to participate as an equal member in that group, or are you only looking at sort of the GitHub style participation?
So the GitHub is to have the community, some way for the community to communicate with us. But anyone can talk with us and it will be at the same level as we are. The fact that this is internally developed here doesn't mean that people out there don't have the same level of voice than we have. The thing is, we have a team specifically allocated just doing this. And if you want to help us, talk with us through email, IRC, some channel, and we will hear you, and we will either help you and adapt to your needs. There's no difference between us if a member is in the room or out there.
Very good. And we're almost out of time. So with that in mind, is there anything that we haven't covered that you want to make sure our audience is aware of?
No, I think what I would like the most is if you know someone that has a school that is an administrator on a school or does IT on a school, and you are facing the same problems that we have, even if we do not support your country right now, give us a call, because we are more than welcome to adapt our software to your country and your school needs, because we want to know more realities about education to make both the student information system and the learning platform the best ones out there. And we want to work with you in making that a reality. So I hope to hear about those out there who are facing the same problems that we have right now.
Oh, very cool, and especially I can tell since the chat room has been pretty excited about this so far. I do have two questions I must ask you, or I get email about it. I really do get email about it if I don't ask these questions, so forgive me for a moment here. What's your favorite scripting language?
Python. I have a three-tier solution for problems, or a multi-tier solution for problems. If it's a textual problem, I use Perl. If it's prototyping a web service and a solution, first I use Python and Django to prototype it. And when I need it to go to production, I use Java. And as things need to be optimized, I go to Go, C, C++, and so on. And that's my workflow, my development workflow. So Python and Perl are out there.
That's a very appropriate answer, actually, and you saved yourself there by starting with the word Perl on at least one part of that. And again, also, favorite text editor?
Originally, I used to use Emacs, but my .emacs became out of control. I stopped being able to maintain it. So I moved to Sublime because it's like Emacs, but it's a bit more maintainable. My .emacs, I have it online actually, but it's a mess and I need to work not to develop my .emacs.
And so what are you using now? I missed that.
Sublime Text. It's a commercial text editor.
Yeah, I've heard about that. I think actually I've played with it once, but that's not something that I invoke every day either. So there we go. Hey, it's been really great talking with you. It sounds like you're working on trying to solve some very complex problems, and you have at least some decent resources to throw at it and have been fairly successful at that. So I appreciate you coming on. I know a lot of new people will now be curious about this project and be willing to give it a try. So thank you for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me.
Very cool. That was Artur Ventura talking to us about, I mispronounced it earlier, FenixEDU. What do you think, Simon?
It's a very interesting project. It seems to have a little bit of everything in it to be a very comprehensive system for universities. I think that they're just waiting for the threshold of a university to adopt it and take it beyond the scope of the Portuguese education system. And I thought it was actually quite interesting that there was someone in the chat room who is doing the sort of work that FenixEDU would serve right now. So maybe we're about to see FenixEDU step out of the Portuguese shadows and into the international spotlight.
Well, and especially if they're doing some stuff with the EU, and I like the fact that it's anglicized already. That's usually like, especially stuff that happens overseas, it's usually like the third or fourth step. So it does actually give option to those of us that, Americans who speak only one language can also take a look at this and maybe do some useful stuff with it. I'm concerned, though, and I think you were trying to get to this too a little bit, I'm concerned about the use of the LGPL and the lack then of assignment, because that means they're probably going to be stuck with that for a while. Is that your impression?
Yes. I mean, I thought they've probably got wider issues than that. I think that they're in an environment where people are picking their code up and leeching off it, which I think is always very regrettable. And if I was involved in their project, I'd be wanting to get together a think tank to work out why that leeching is happening. Because, with open source, it's in your interests to contribute back. And if people don't contribute back, it's usually because there's an obstacle. And I'd want to understand what that obstacle was, whether it was related to the LGPL, whether it was related to the development team being internal. Whatever reason it was, I think it would probably need addressing if the project is going to go big, well beyond the scope of this school. Having said that, the project is already pretty big. I mean, there's a lot of code. They've got a lot of students whose education is dependent on it. But I think that, there are some amber flags, some yellow flags that I see in there about the choice of license, the relationship with the existing people who would be committers if they were able to be. and the scope of people to engage with the project. I love the fact they're very open to people getting involved with the project. I'm a little concerned by the idea that you'd need to tell them to change things if it didn't fit your environment. Most people won't do that as the first step of an evaluation.
Yeah, true. And I'm curious. We can play internet lawyers here for a second. You can probably do it better than I can. I'm confused about why, when the consultant creates the code and then distributes it to the school system that they're writing the code for, that doesn't trigger the distribution clause of the GPL.
Well, it does. The distribution clause of the GPL says that if I give you the binary, I am entitled to ask you for the source. The point that Artur was making, however, was that there's a very limited number of people those consultants distribute to, and they're the only people entitled to ask for the source, and they have no motivation to do so. So, that the GPL is a lot less onerous than people think it is. It doesn't give you a duty to distribute your code freely to everybody. It only gives you a duty to provide the source to the people who have the binary. And what's more, you don't actually have to actively give them the source. You can simply make an offer of source. So when people have got some external reason why they don't want to contribute back, it's very easy for you to not contribute back under the GPL.
Well, this I learned today. This is amazing. I've been playing with the GPL for decades, I guess, now, and I sort of had the impression that once you chose the GPL, it meant everybody that changed things had to make their source available.
No, you have to make an offer of source. That's what you have to do under the GPL v2. And that's, actually, I've got a document here on my desk somewhere. I've actually got a compliance leaflet that came with a router that I bought from a Taiwanese company. I can't see it here on the desk now to show you. But what they do is that when I opened the router, this little piece of paper fell out, and printed on it, it says that if I send that piece of paper off to this address in Taiwan with an international money order for $10, they'll send me the source. And that's all you have to do to satisfy the terms of the GPL is make an offer of source, and you only have to do it for 3 years. You don't have to do it for in perpetuity. So the GPL isn't anywhere near as onerous as people paint it to be. That's really, in many ways, FUD by people who don't like the giving back clause of the GPL.
Interesting. And I was just curious, does it require a machine readable?
It's you have to provide the source in a form that would in which the code would normally be used by a programmer. So readable is required, yeah.
Very good, very good. All right, we could talk about this for hours. In fact, it's funny. I've gotten many requests over the years that you and I, and maybe we can get some of the guys from I'm forgetting who the license expert is. We should just do a show entirely just on licenses. Actually, we sort of did one of those a couple of years ago. I think we interviewed. I forget his name. He's going to yell at me for that. Bradley Kuhn. Did a lot
Bradley's
of good
lessons. But absolutely. Like you and I, he only plays a lawyer on TV. He isn't actually one.
all good. Well, Simon, let me go ahead and finish up the show here. Coming up next week, we have Core OS, which is Linux for massive server deployments. Right after that, we have the RethinkDB, which is one of these non-SQL distributed databases for JSON documents. Claims to have some of the things figured out that are really, really cool. I know we had one on a few weeks ago that was sort of like that. We have the Docker show, which has now been moved twice. I am assured that the likelihood of it happening this time is probably higher than the previous two times, but nothing higher than that. But Docker, very important thing. In fact, it was actually mentioned in today's show, being able to deploy VMs that are much easier to move things around, all that sort of stuff. Also rounding out the schedule so far is OpenSMTPD. How many consonants is that in a row? That's OpenBSD's contribution to the SMTPD space, being a very secure mail server. But we do have a few more slots to still fill in Q4. I am working on that, sending out a bunch of emails probably this weekend to try to fill the remaining slots of that, and also trying to fill a couple of host and co-host pairs so that while I am on a cruise ship going to the Canary Islands, There'll be somebody there to man the helm while I'm gone. You can view all this activity at twitch.tv/floss, our homepage. Linking from there is, in fact, our big spreadsheet, the giant spreadsheet. Actually, it manages a Google spreadsheet. If you have a project that's not on that sheet, be sure to email the project leader and have them email me saying, I want to be on Floss Weekly. That's how these shows all happen. You guys are driving the show, and I really appreciate that. For the last 4 or 5 years, the show has been almost entirely crowdsourced, and that is cool for me. My email, of course, is merlin@stunnage.com. It's there on that homepage, so I make it very public. I don't know, no spam obscuration or anything like that. You can follow us on Floss Weekly on Google Plus. I announce the shows as they come up. I also try to get a 1 hour or 1 day announcement out as well about who is actually coming up. That gets mirrored to Floss Weekly on Twitter. We do have a live chat. We took a number of questions to live chat today. We normally tape at 8:30 a.m. Pacific time on Wednesdays. It's currently UTC-7, but it's going to be UTC-8 in about 3 weeks, I think it is. So be careful about that if you're an international listener. We do. I also post. I have a Google Plus handle, Randall L. Schwartz. I also then gets mirrored over to Twitter and Facebook. My Twitter account is Merlin with a Y. Just settled this. I'm going to be in the Buffalo area, Buffalo, New York, hopefully before the big freeze. It's probably going to be a little snowy there, though. From November 3rd to November 14th, if you're in that area, please reach me using one of these communication methods and say, hey, I want to meet up and stuff. Looks like we're already looking at a Pearl users group meeting in downtown Buffalo. Coming up, I think, on the 7th of November, but I'll announce more about that on all the usual channels once I get there. I am also trying to arrange, get set up a London meetup, as we did about 6 months ago, on, I think the date's going to be November 29th. So if you're in the London-ish area, be thinking about that as well. I'll also be in the Brick House for New Year's Eve for the 3 a.m. to 3 a.m. rocking in for 24 hours, the Twit Live Brick House presentation. I'll try to get into as much of that as I can stay awake for. That's all I want to announce right now. Simon, what would you like to plug?
Well, first of all, I'd like to ask for somebody to pay my airfare to fly into that New Year's Eve party. coming up soon, I've got to look at this computer over here to see it all. I've got Open World Forum coming up in Paris. That's next week. That's one of Europe's largest open source conferences and exhibitions. That's happening right in the center of Paris, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday next week. I'm heading over to California after that for the OSI board meeting. And I would love to meet any listeners and viewers who are in the San Francisco Bay Area. Maybe we can get together for a drink one evening in the week of the 10th of November. I'll be at SUSACon in Orlando the week of the 17th of November. If you're not traveling to get to all of those things, you'll find pointers to most of the other things I do on webmink.com. And I would love it if you read my column in InfoWorld every week. That's the open sources column. And in particular, if you said wonderful things about it to my editor so he knows it's still worth having open source in his enterprise publication. That's pretty much it from me. You can find me on Twitter. You'll find me on Google+. I occasionally show up in other places as well. I'm trying LO at the moment and finding that there's a lot of tumbleweed blowing across my lists of contacts there.
Interesting. Well, thank you, Simon. Once again, your comments are always very apropos in terms of, especially in terms of licensing and governance. So I appreciate that. And you had some nice, you surprised me. You had some very interesting technical questions today. That was slightly shocking. I guess your background is much broader than you ever admit. So that's thank you for all those wonderful technical questions.
I've been programming since 1978, Randall.
Okay.
And I learned Motorola 6800 assembler first. And then COBOL. I then wrote a Pascal compiler and a BASIC compiler. I've done all sorts of interesting things. I was on, and then I've been on standards committees. I've been involved in X400 and X500, done all sorts of things over the years. I've just been de-skilled by being in executive roles, that's all.
Yeah, okay, yeah. I guess, you know, as soon as you start wearing the tie, it starts cutting off the circulation to this programmer part of your brain. That's what I've heard. Very good. Well, Simon, once again, yeah, thank you for joining me for today's show. And we'll see you all again next week on Floss Weekly.